Doctors of Reddit, what's your thank God they came in for a second opinion moment? Hosted by BYU, Big Juicy, 724. I have a story of a friend who was severely mismanaged. I've probably posted it before, but I'm too lazy to look. For 2 years, my friend had been going to her GP complaining about migraines, bouts of severe vomiting, and dizzy spells. Every time, he would order blood work, then tell her she was fine. One morning, she woke up, and after a sexy morning with her husband, could barely stand. She was so dizzy and had such a bad migraine. She told her husband not to worry, sent him to work and had her neighbor drive her to the emergency room. She doesn't remember arriving. When she got there, she started acting erratic. They had to sedate her, and sent her for a CT scan of her head. There, they noticed a huge mass in her brain. The hospital wasn't equipped to deal with that, so they sent her by ambulance to the nearest hospital they could, a 4-hour drive away. This hospital immediately sent her for an MRI. It wasn't a mass. They could actually see the mass growing as they did the MRI. No, she was having a massive stroke. She was immediately taken in for surgery. They put in a stent and had to remove most of the left side of her brain as it was all dead. Afterwards, she was in a coma for nearly 72 hours. They were uncertain if she would wake up, and if she did, if she would ever recover. Thankfully, she did. It took almost a year of physio and speech therapy, among a few others, but she has made almost a complete recovery. They even had their first child 8 months ago. A 30-year-old man with mild depressive symptoms was in and out of the hospital fairly quickly. He was under pressure from his home life, living with 4 roommates who were making life a bit difficult for him. No suicidal thoughts. He was cleared of all psychopathologies by me and 2 other doctors. A few months later he came back. Same symptoms, however this time he talked about 5 roommates. It felt wrong, and I digged into his story. Tried to contact his roommates. He lived alone and was severely psychotic. I have no idea to this day how he hid it so well from everyone. Edit, a few more details, the patient talked, dressed and acted normally, however after admitting him for a longer period we noticed he talked with his roommates, often. He was single, no contact with his family and somehow working, however in a routine job with little to no personal contact. After a few talks he also claimed other people's thoughts were sometimes thrown at him and sitting on his head, and he could thus read people's minds against his will. The interesting thing about this patient was that his internal world somehow fitted the external world when asked. His roommates sounded perfectly plausible, they were not e.g. shadow people, Vikings, 12 meters tall, and they teased him by hiding his stuff. But he ate with them, watched TV with them, so on. Normally a person with paranoid schizophrenia, paranoid meaning all types of delusions, will have multiple symptoms sometimes easy to see for the untrained eye. The patients can dress, talk and present themselves in odd ways, usually different from cultural norms. They can have incoherent speech, make up words and phrases or are clearly separated from reality. Another patient of mine insisted that I was in jail for medicating him, even when we talked. When we quickly scan a patient for psychotic symptoms, we basically look for inconsistencies in the patient's experience of the world. The patients normally know something is wrong or weird or different, but often believe it is the world around them that have changed. This is due to discrepancy between what they experience, input, failed assessment of the inputs, due to the thinking disorder, and testing hypothesis based on failed assessments which collide with the real world. This will activate defense mechanisms, FX denial, wild explanations, accepting both realities at the same time, and so on. E.g., I am not sick, my doctor must be a bad guy, bad guys are in jail, my doctor are in jail, but my doctor is sitting right in front of me at the same time, he must have an identical twin or this is an alternate reality. This is usually the way delusions are made. To summarize, when we scan for psychosis, we look for inconsistencies between the patient's subjective experience of thinking, being and acting and the objective reality accepted by the general cultural norm. This patient managed to live in a subjective psychotic world that just fitted so well with the objective reality that he tricked several psychiatrists, including myself. I've had a couple of gems, but the one that really sticks out in my mind actually happened about a month or so ago. A young mother brought in a 6-year-old to the emergency room. She was super nice and apologetic because she thought that she was wasting my time, because she said that her son had started to develop different spots all over his body and she has no idea why. My initial first thought was chicken pox, so I had some swords and shields up ready to go for the anti-vax debate, but she claimed that she had her son vaccinated at all stages up to that point, and upon closer inspection they were massive clusters of warts. Not uncommon, but because of how rapidly that they were growing, I ordered some blood work to make sure there wasn't an underlying cause, as kids' immune systems are pretty well equipped to handle that sort of thing. And I'm really glad that she brought him in, because he had a severely low white blood cell count, which revealed a primary immune deficiency disease. This is my second story to post here, but a great story no less. Mid-30s man walks into my office with what looks like a black eye and a broken blood vessel in the front of his left eye. He went to his primary and it was simply assumed that he got punched or hit or something, and he was dismissed. He was noted to have high blood pressure, but a script for medicine was written and a follow-up in a few months. Gentleman comes in to see me to get another opinion on the matter, and I look at him and immediately start the line of questions. How long has it been there? Do you have a headache? And when you plug your ears with your fingers, do you hear a whooshing sound? He had a cavernous sinus fistula, CCF. I sent him directly to the emergency room with his family of four in tow, and he was in the OR within an hour of arriving. Saved his eye and possibly his life that day. The best news, he was a kitchen guy at my local diner which I frequent, and they still treat me like royalty there when I come to eat. They all remember the time I saved one of theirs. This is a I wish I had gotten a second opinion story. I had a doctor in high school who was unconcerned when I suddenly developed vertical double vision, which was freaking out everyone in emergency, where I had gone initially, and lost 60 pounds for no reason. It was only a year or two later when I told him that my arm would fall asleep much faster than normal when I raised it to ask a question in class, that he thought there might be something wrong with me. MRI ordered. Brain tumor found. My grandmother had her hip replaced, but the hip always hurt to her. She waited a year, hoping it would go away, but it never did. She asked multiple doctors and did multiple x-rays, but doctors said the replaced hip was fine. We finally made her go to a private clinic in my hometown, and the doctor saw that the replaced hip was fine and dandy, but the bone around it looked like it was a tad bit eaten by bacteria. So the new doc did an operation, and there was so much pus in the leg it was insane. If my grandmother waited any longer, her blood would become infected and she would have died. Thank goodness she went to the clinic. I doctor here. I had a patient I saw several months before they came in for their visit, but well less than a year, which often means something could be wrong. In this case, as it turns out, nothing was wrong with her by way of complaints. She just wanted to get updated before getting some new glasses. We decided to just run the regular gamut of tests anyway, just because we might as well while she was there. She was a 50-year-old woman, fairly normal exam, perfect vision, retinas showed healthy, but something about her pupils really bothered me before I dilated. We chatted about it and I asked her if she banged her head or anything weird, and she said no, but suddenly reveals this crazy history of an old meningioma, a type of tumorous brain growth, she had removed a few years ago. She had decided to omit this from her history with us as she didn't feel it was important, but we went and put it into the charts anyway. Turns out she got a CT done 2 weeks prior to her exam with me, which she says turns up completely normal. I tell her she should tell her doctor about this anyway, just to cover our bases. Fast forward, patient shows up in my office ecstatic to tell me that my examination revealed that her tumor had returned with an incredible vengeance. She had no idea, was totally asymptomatic, and the CT she had prior to me showed what was very literally the size of a speck of dust, which the radiologist dismissed as artifact. on her return to her doctor, they decided to rerun the CT to cover the bases, and they found a quarter-sized tumor. Within 2 weeks, the tumor went from the size of a dust particle to a quarter. She was rushed into emergency surgery as the tumor was growing super fast and was close to a blood vessel which could cause a massive stroke. She had it removed that day and returned to me after recovery to tell me of what got discovered as a result of my testing. She is now a long-time regular patient I have been seeing for about 10 years. Edit, thank you kind giver of gold and silver. It's good to be gilded. Edit, for those asking about the pupils, they were asymmetric, and the larger one reacted less robustly compared to the fellow eye. This was a marked change from her previous examinations where no pupillary defects were noted. Had a guy come in for a second opinion after the first place didn't bother asking any medical history. Of course, I took his history and asked more questions as we went. I remember telling him something felt off and we needed to run a test. So I ordered a peripheral vision test. When I got the test back, I was shocked by the most classic tumor pattern I'd ever seen. 2 weeks later, he was in surgery to get it removed. A month after, this guy was back in my clinic thanking me. Totally different guy. Personality was a complete 180, energetic and happy. Edit, here's another one I thought of, though a bit more sad. But also good at the same time. Here's a cautionary tale why urgent care should never treat eye issues. Lady was referred to me after 2 weeks of treated for a red painful eye. The PA and MDs that saw her tried allergy meds and antibiotic is thinking it was allergic or bacterial conjunctivitis, or hoping it was mild viral that would resolve on its own. So I took one look at her and knew it was a herpes simplex infection in her cornea. She was in pain and had been mistreated for 2 weeks. Got her on antivirals, but after discussing how it was odd she didn't have any active herpetic sores, but had a really bad cough that the ER said was just pneumonia and would go away with antibiotics. I told her to get it checked with a pulmonologist because it didn't sound like pneumonia and it wasn't getting better. I saw her 3 months later to monitor her corneal appearance and she came in using a wheelchair. Turns out the pulmonologist was blown away that the ER had dismissed her. She had a really rare small cell lung cancer. The reason the herpes infection manifested in the first place was her immune system was compromised. She told me the pulmonologist said I'd saved her life because they caught it early. It's been a bit over a year. She's still undergoing treatment but her spirits are strong and she's optimistic, as is the pulmonologist. I'm an emergency medicine doc in the Midwest USA. The patient was transferred from rural nowhere to our tertiary care facility, big hospital with every specialist. Call was of really bad quality, but the transferring physician described a 21-year-old male that had rapid heart rate and breathing rate, low blood pressure, low oxygen, confusion, and a severe opacification on his chest X-ray on the right side. Diagnosed pneumonia. He gave him a ton of fluids, started antibiotics, put him on a ventilator, but he wasn't getting better, and wanted to send him to us. Sure, send away. An hour later the gentleman arrives, and looks young, fit, and not the type to just drop dead from pneumonia. We roll him onto our stretcher and find a huge stab wound in his back. The X-ray finding was his entire right chest full of blood. We put a tube in it, gave him back some blood, and he had to go for surgery to fix the bleeding. Lesson, look at your patient. A bit of background, in my field of audiology we have people licensed to diagnose not only hearing issues but balance disorders and other factors impacting listening and understanding. We also have another field who popped up when it was not considered as ethical for us to treat those more serious hearing issues, i.e. with hearing aids, but they don't need the same doctorate level training, just barely high school or some college depending on jurisdiction. So I had a patient come in with a serious difference between left and right hearing, and this in itself is considered a red flag because both ears are exposed to the same things over time, and there are very few explanations as to why one would get so bad. the patient could hardly understand words on that bad side and the better ear was pretty good overall, just minor hearing loss perhaps age-related. Immediately upon seeing these test results, the ENT and I agreed to send this patient for an MRI of the head because something was off. The patient confirmed no MRI or medical treatment had been recommended in the past and only hearing aids by this lesser-trained hearing aid dealer working for a popular US chain. The patient had been wearing these hearing aids already for a few years. The MRI results came back. Massive tumor on the hearing nerve. The hearing aid dealer is being investigated currently for malpractice, or more specifically a violation of state laws regarding red flags. That is the end of today's video, everyone. Thanks for watching. Please like, subscribe and add your comments below.